Yeah, never mind the hug. Never mind the hug. Well, glory. Thank you, Jesus. The one-armed apostle is here. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Father. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for our service tonight. We thank you for everyone, the Lord, that has chosen the good part to come and be a part of our service this evening. Lord, we thank you for the praise and the worship. We thank you for the freedom we have in America to gather together like this tonight without the fear of persecution or arrest, unlike what many people have to experience around the world. So we don't take all of this or any of this for granted, Lord, but we thank you for the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit. We come with open hearts and eyes to see and ears to hear what you have from your word for us here tonight. So we thank you in advance, Lord. Everything we do for you. And in your name we pray that you may be glorified tonight and throughout eternity through this church and all of those out there preaching your word without apology or compromise. And we praise and thank you for this in Jesus' name. Everybody that agrees with this said together, amen. All right, everybody, back up and park. And get comfortable around God's word. Just in case you don't know why I'm wearing this sling, bicycling is my hobby of choice when I'm not preaching and just something to do to stay in shape and keep the old Pueblo in good condition, you know. And about 10 days ago, I just had a bike crash and broke my wrist. So I'm in the process of receiving my healing. So if you'd be so kind, please agree with me for that. Amen. Amen. It's always better to have two hands to slap the devil around rather than just one. You can go twice as far and do twice as much damage. Praise the Lord. All right. How many have their Bibles or their Bible app or your device that you brought to church tonight? Let me just follow up with what Pastor Luke said a moment ago. We appreciate so much this church. This is one of our churches. This is our home church, and we love to be here. Whenever we can. We travel so much, we're not here very often, but whenever we're able to come and be a part of service, it's always just a refreshing to us to be here and to be a part of the service. And so we just want to thank you on behalf of my wife and my staff overseas and all of the churches that we have in our network around the country. We appreciate everything you do to help us obey God in the Philippines. And we're believing God for 7,000 souls saved this summer. Please agree with us for this in Jesus' name. We've got a church network of 150 churches and a Bible school that's graduating people going out to reproduce our vision in many, many parts of the country where we ourselves would never even go. So all of that is because of churches like The Rock that help us do what we do for the Lord. So we say thank you to you for that in Jesus' name. All right, let's go to Joshua chapter number 1. I'm reading from the New King James Version here this evening. And we're going to look at verse number 8. Now, most of the verses that we're going to look at tonight, you've probably heard them many times in church services and sermons from this church, from this pulpit, from all the leadership here. But we're going to take a different slant tonight, I hope, and perhaps you'll see things differently that you've never seen before. A refreshing look, a different perspective. Joshua chapter 1, verse 8, God says this, "This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate in it day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have good success." How many like to be prosperous and successful? God promises this to us. He wants us to prosper, and he wants us to be successful. And there's no shortage of people running around preaching prosperity messages and success seminars and increase meetings and all of these other titles that they use. Nothing wrong with any of that per se, but I want us to see this verse from God's perspective tonight and not from ours. Okay, he wants us to prosper and he wants us to be successful, but there are reasons why he wants us to prosper and why he wants us to be successful. And it has nothing to do with us. But it has something to do with what we can do to reach and help somebody else. And so prosperity is scriptural. Success is scriptural. Don't apologize for standing in faith for it. Expect it, believe for it, and rejoice when you get it. But when we get it, let's know what we're going to do when we get it. When we receive it, let's know why God wants us to be successful and why he wants us to prosper. Having said that, I want you to turn with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. We'll just kind of quickly go through these verses to set a pace here and a pattern. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Look with me at verse number 17. Once again, very familiar passages. 2 Corinthians 5:17. Now, I want us to read these verses tonight in the light of what we just saw from Joshua chapter 1 about this promise of prosperity and success. Okay? 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Verse 18. Now all things are of God, who has reconciled us to himself through Jesus Christ, and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, verse 19, that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, not imputing their trespasses to them, and has committed to us the word of reconciliation. Now, according to these three verses, three things happened when we accepted Jesus, okay? If you accepted Jesus, if you made him the Lord of your life, according to what we just read, three things took place at the time you did that. According to verse 17, you became a new creation. Old things were passed away, all things became new. All of the past sins, the mistakes made, the promises broken, all of that was washed away by the blood of Jesus, and we start over. We are new creations in Christ Jesus as if we have never existed before. That's what it implies from the Greek, okay? We start over. We're new creations. We're new creatures. Then verse 18, when that happened, when you received your new birth experience, when you were recreated from the inside out, God gave us something. When you did it, when I did it, when we did it, we got something from God. We were given something. According to verse 18, we were given a ministry. Now, many Christians don't realize this, but when you got saved, you were given a ministry. God gave you something, and according to verse 18, it's a ministry of reconciliation. And then verse 19 is what that ministry is all about. What is the ministry of reconciliation? It's the word of reconciliation. It's the message that the sinner is no longer at odds with God, that Jesus has come. He was made to be sin for us. Sin at one time separated us from God in the Old Testament, but Jesus came. He was made to be sin. He took the place of sin. He removed the sin, took it out of the way. Now what remains between man and God is Jesus. He's in between. That's why he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man can come to the Father except through me. That's because we've been reconciled, and that's the message we share, because that's the ministry we have when we got saved. And then looking back to Joshua chapter 1, verse 8, the reason for why God wants us to prosper and the reason for why he wants us to be successful is to fund that ministry. Your ministry needs to be funded. My ministry needs to be funded. That's why God wants us to prosper, because nothing is for free, okay? When we fly to the Philippines, we have to buy airplane tickets. I cannot walk up to the counter at United Airlines and say, behold, dost thou not knowest who I ameth? I am a child of God, divinely sent by the Holy Spirit to go to the Philippines to set at liberty them that are bruised, to preach the gospel, to turn them from darkness to light, and from the power of Satan to the power of God. That's where I'm going, and that's why I'm getting on your jet. And they will say, that is all so wonderful and so fine and so good, but if you want to board that jet back there, behold the price. So we need to be prosperous and successful to do what we're told to do. All of us have a ministry. It's the ministry of reconciliation. How that will manifest in each believer's life is between them and God. You know, everybody's different. We go different places and we have different assignments to meet different people at different times and all of that. But the point is, prosperity and success is part of God's plan for us to fulfill and find our purpose for why we are here. Okay? So then our responsibility, look with me at Colossians 4:17. Our responsibility, therefore, is very simple. If we understand that God wants to prosper us, wants us to be successful, to fund the ministry of reconciliation and the word we preach because we got saved and because we're now members of the body of Christ with responsibility to the world, because of this, here's where it all ends, right here. Colossians 4:17, this is talking about a man named Archippus, but applies to all of us as well. Say to Archippus, take heed to the ministry which you have received in the Lord, that you may fulfill it. That's all God wants from us. You don't have to make it complicated, because it isn't. God wants to fulfill and to fund your ministry. He wants you to understand that, and that's why the Holy Spirit is here to help us, each and every one of us, do what we're supposed to do, to share Jesus with other people, to let them know that they've been reconciled to God, that their sins are no longer an issue, and praise God, there's nothing standing between them except and God except Jesus. Amen. So it's scriptural to want to prosper, and it's scriptural to want to succeed. But the point is, we need to understand how that comes to pass, okay? 6 years ago, let me share a brief story with you. I was at Rhema attending their winter Bible seminar in 2010. And they had a missionary luncheon, and I was invited with my wife to attend, and so we were there. And they were roaming around table to table asking about who we were and where we worked and what was going on. So I told them who we were and what was going on and so forth. And they were intrigued by what I shared, apparently. So they asked me, they said, you know, we'd like to do an article on you and the ministry that you're doing in the Philippines. So if you don't mind, can you come over to the ministries of Kenneth Hagin Ministries tomorrow at such and such a time at such and such an office, and I'd like to interview you. And we'll put a tape recorder on the table, and we'll just ask you questions about how you've come to succeed over these many years, at that time 30 years from September of 1980 until 2010, moving up to September of that year. So I said, fine. So I went the next day. Now, I didn't know what they were going to ask me. I didn't come with notes. They didn't say, we're going to talk about this, and so, you know, spend a little time with the Lord and prepare your thoughts and get a few verses together. I didn't know what they were going to ask me. I just showed up. So they sat down with the microphone there on the table, and they started asking me questions about the ministry there and how things went and all of this, the history of it and so forth, you know. And so I began talking. So my point to you tonight is, I didn't know what I was going to share, but God did. Out of my heart, things started coming up. I was sitting there listening to myself talk. Anybody know what I'm talking about? When the Holy Spirit starts talking through you, you didn't think it up. He's the one talking through you, and I'm sitting there listening. This is really good. You know, acting like I put this all together myself. Well, God's the one actually speaking through me. So what I want to share with you when it comes to the success of the ministry that you're responsible for, I want to talk about some of the keys to success that you can look to that will ensure the success of your ministry so that someday, you know, when you stand before the Lord, you can give a good account of yourself before the Lord God Almighty. Anybody interested? I want to be able to hear God say, well done, good and faithful servant, when I stand before the Lord to answer for the life I lived. Amen. I want to hear well done, not just well. Where'd you disappear to for 30 years? You know, I don't want to hear that. I want to hear well done, good and faithful servant. So how to be and how to stay successful in ministry for Jesus. And these are things that came up out of my heart, and I just want to share them with you. Things that God has brought back to me and instructed me to share here with you tonight. Number one, here's what I heard myself say. When they were asking me, what are the keys to success for your ministry overseas and all the people you've led to the Lord, the churches you've built and so forth, here's what I said. Here's the first thing that came out of my heart. Number one, maintain humility, but remain tenacious. Maintain humility, but remain tenacious. Now let's talk about that for just a few minutes. Humility and tenacity. Humility deals with the fact that we are what we are by the grace of God, okay? You and I are nothing outside of Jesus. Can anyone agree? Do we all agree that apart from Christ, we are nothing? 1 Corinthians 15:10 is the classic verse. We are what we are by the grace of God, and the grace of God was not given to us in vain, but we labored more abundantly than they all, but it's not us, but it's the grace of God laboring with us. Okay? We are what we are by the grace of God. Don't ever sit there thinking that you're better than someone else. I should never be thinking that I'm better than you or you're better than me. Because all of us are products of the grace of God. We're just gifted in different areas because we've been given different assignments. But at the end of the day, we are what we are by God's grace and no other reason and no other way. Okay? So remain humble. You know, no matter what God is doing through you, or no matter how God is using you in whatever way, no matter how impressive the results may appear to be, always remember, it's all because of the grace of God. Amen. It's an honor for me to stand here before you and share the word of God. I've done this for 36 years, and every time I do it, it's like I'm doing it for the first time. That God would choose to use someone like me to share messages, to find folks like you, is an honor and a privilege that I never get tired of stepping back and in awe, just admiring God for how he chose to use me to do this. Amen. I'm just a person like you, and you're just a person like me. Amen. We all need everybody else. Everybody needs everybody else. Amen. And everybody's important in the grand scheme of things. So let's stay humble and not be roaming around, you know, with a puffed up head thinking we're better than someone else because we're not. Okay? Now, on this issue of tenacity, it's been my experience around the globe as I've been, interacting with Christians in different countries and different cultures, most Christians love the Lord, but they have no idea what tenacity is all about. Like Pastor Luke said a few minutes ago, you have to have an attitude. You're going to offend some people along the way. There's no two ways about it. Jesus offended people, you know, and we're going to offend people too. But the point is, the devil is not going to stand back and let us go do whatever we want to go do for the Lord. He's going to try to contest everything we do. He's going to fight every step of the way. You have to develop this attitude simultaneously with humility. You have to have this attitude of tenacity. You have to go after things for God, and you have to be willing to do whatever it takes to get there. Okay, now my hero when it comes to things like this is the man Caleb in the Old Testament. How many remember Joshua and Caleb? Two of the 12 spies, the two that gave the good report, Joshua and Caleb. They, you know, let us go over it once and possess the land where we are well able to take it, you know, while the other 10 are whining and complaining. Okay, look with me at Joshua chapter 14. Let's quickly read a few verses here. Joshua 14 and verse 6. Let's look at some of the things he said that might inspire us here tonight. Joshua 14 and verse 6. Now this is when the promised land is being divvied up, okay? And Joshua is going to hack it all up, you know, and give it to the 12 tribes. And Joshua is giving all these, you know, parcels out. And here comes Caleb. And he says in verse 6, the children of Judah came to Joshua in Gilgal. And Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, the Kenizzite, said to him, you know the word which the Lord said to Moses, the man of God, concerning you and me in Kadesh Barnea. I was 40 years old when Moses, the servant of the Lord, sent me from Kadesh Barnea to spy out the land, and I brought him back word as it was in my heart. Nevertheless, my brethren who went up with me made the heart of the people melt, but I wholly followed the Lord my God. Now, Moses swore on that day, saying, surely the land where your foot has trodden shall be your inheritance and your children's forever, because you have wholly followed the Lord my God. And now behold, the Lord has kept me alive, as he said, these 45 years. Everyone say 45 years?
45 years.
Not 45 minutes. 45 years, ever since the Lord spoke this word to Moses while Israel wandered in the wilderness, and now here I am this day, 85 years old, and I am as strong this day as on the day Moses sent me. Just as my strength was then, so now is my strength for war, both for going out and for coming in. Therefore, give me this mountain, etc. Now, I don't know about you, but I don't know too many 85-year-old people that roam around claiming things like this guy did. You know, 85. And this man, while wandering in the wilderness with all the unbelieving complainers for 40 years plus 5, okay, to divvy up the land, 45 years have passed, he walked up to Joshua and word for word quoted what Moses told him 45 years before that. Without the benefit of word processing, computers, filing cabinets, all the things we've got at our disposal today, he just day by day held on to what Moses said and quoted it back to Joshua 45 years later, word for word, at the age of 85, and said, I've been waiting 45 years to take that mountain, because if you continue reading, the Anakim were up there, the giants are up there. He says, I wanted to fight them 45 years ago, and I was denied because of the unbelieving people out there. They've all died off. Now give me that mountain. I want to go up there and take them out. I've been waiting for this. What an attitude. Let me tell you, God would be embarrassed not to give him that mountain. This is the kind of tenacity. No wonder God said this guy's got a different spirit about him. Where is that in the church? This is what we need out here today. Now more than ever, we need people like this. We don't need, you know, an 85-year-old guy talking this way. I'm as strong today as I was on the day Moses sent me. Are you kidding? He's not down at the bingo parlor on Friday night with all the other seniors. My man's out there on the front lines. He's got his sword in his hand. He's ready to engage the enemy. This is the kind of tenacity we're looking for. This is what we need. Amen. And if you don't have it, you're one decision away from getting it. Amen. It's time to gut up, as I say to my staff overseas. Gut up and get in the game. Quit wallowing and whining about how difficult things are. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. When I was 10 years old, our family was blessed with a chihuahua. let me tell you. Now, if you have one, God bless you. But here's the point. Our neighbor had one, you know, and that dog had a litter. And so our neighbor and my parents were friends. And so they gave my parents a member of the litter, you know, a little dog. And we named him Mickey. Mickey the Chihuahua. And I was about 10 years old. I don't want to, you know, about you, maybe you've got a Yorkie or a little terrier or a Chihuahua like that. What is it about the small dogs? The ones that are going, yep, 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 yep. It looks like they're having a seizure every time they bark. Their tail's wagging, you know, their legs are going all over the place, you know. This dog did not know how small it was. You could hold that dog in the palm of your hand. I'm not kidding. He could sit on the palm of your hand. He was that small. He only weighed a couple grams, you know. And he would sit on top of the couch next to the window where he could oversee the property, his kingdom. And he would guard that with his life. I mean, he would just, anything that came on the property, dogs, cats, postmen delivering mail, the milkman, anybody that came up the driveway, this dog went berserk. He's going to defend his kingdom, you know, and us along with it. I mean, he had an attitude, this little thing. He didn't know how small he was. And I was meditating on these things, and God brought that dog back to my remembrance. I'd forgotten this, but I used to play tug of war with this dog. Now, I was about 10 years old, you know, so I'm much bigger than he is even at that young age. I balled up a sock, a couple socks, and made a lumpy thing there so he could grab hold of one end, and I had hold of the other end, and we would play tug of war, me and the dog. Okay, Mickey, me and Mickey. And we'd just go back and forth, and he'd get on his end of that sock, and he'd bite down, and he would not let go, growling, you know. Going back and forth. You know, this is going on for like 10, 15, 20 minutes, and he is not letting go of that rag. First of all, I was sort of amused by it, you know, but as time went by, I started to get pretty annoyed. You know, I'll get you, I'll show you, you know, and the dog would not let go. You know, across the linoleum floor, back and forth we go. You know, no tile back in those days, it was all linoleum, you know, zoom, zoom, zoom back, you know, and he would not let go. So I said, I'll get you, and I picked him up off the ground. I'm holding him in the air like this. I got my sock, and he's on the other end of the sock, hanging in midair, slowly twirling. I got him up in the air, and he won't let go. I'm amazed. I'm thinking, you got to be kidding me. I'll show you. By now, it's, you know, it's me against the dog. You know, I'm on a mission now. I'm going to get him to let go of that rag, you know, whatever it takes. And I mean, I started swinging the rag. Boom, boom. I'm not kidding. Mickey's going around like a helicopter, you know, boom, boom, boom. You know, and then whoosh. I let him go. He never let go. I let him go. Bam, hits the little one, zing, goes across the kitchen floor, slams against the back wall of the house, you know, and then comes back in wagging his tail, you know, with the sock still in his mouth. Like, is that all you got? You got anything better than that? Is that the best you can give me? Mickey the dog. That's the kind of tenacity God loves to see. When you, listen, the promises of God are in Christ, yes and amen. But that doesn't mean the devil's not going to try to take that away from you or prevent you from getting whatever God died through Christ to provide. So you're going to have to go after it. And if people get offended, so be it. We're not out here to win popularity contests. We're out here to do a job for God. Amen? I tell people, you know, there's a heaven, there's a hell. Take your pick. You know, our crusades, you know, the message is pretty in your face. There's a heaven, there's a hell. If you're smart, you'll choose heaven. If you're stupid, you'll choose hell. Take your choice. Well, I don't believe what you have to say. Well, then go to hell. I can't tell you anything else because that's where you're going to go. I just love you enough to tell you up front where you're going to go. If you've got a problem with that, that's your problem, Jack, not mine. This is why counseling for me is about 2 or 3 minutes. We don't beat around the bush, you know, for 45 minutes bemoaning our situation. No, 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 no. It's not the way we work. Okay. So maintain humility but remain tenacious. That's number one. Find the tenacity. Go after it. Be like Caleb. Okay, by the way, the word Caleb in the Hebrew means raging canine madness. In other words, rabid dog. The biting, drooling, seething, tearing, ripping kind of dog. Not just, you know, we're not talking Lassie here. You know, we're not talking, you know, some nice dopey German shepherd that goes along. No, this is, you know, the biting, seething, dangerous, ripping kind of dog. God loves it. Tenacity. Humility coupled with tenacity. Number two, for time, let's move on. This is what I heard myself say to the interviewer that day, way back when. Live your life on the offensive, not the defensive. Do not wait for the devil to attack you. Go after him. Find him. Go out, search and destroy. The military used to have terms called search and destroy. Go out there and find him. Make him pay. Don't wait for him to attack you. You go after him. Don't live a reactionary life. You go out there and make him pay for what he's trying to do to wreck your marriage or wreck your children or whatever else he's trying to do to steal, to kill, and to destroy. Look at John chapter 11, verse number 5. Here's an example of this from our Lord's ministry. John chapter 11 and verse 5. This is the story about how Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead. Lazarus was a good friend of his. Okay, Mary, Martha, and Lazarus were brothers and sisters, and they were supporters of Jesus. So many times when Jesus was in the area, he'd stop by and stay with them and have lunch with them or whatever. Well, as you know, Lazarus got sick and is dying, but not yet dead. Martha comes to let Jesus know that her brother is dire and dying, and please come and help. So the Bible says, you know, verse 5, Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. And verse 6, so when he heard that he was sick, he stayed two more days in the place where he was. Then after this, he said to the disciples, let's go to Judea again. Verse 8, the disciples said to him, Rabbi, lately the Jews sought to stone you. And are you going there again? They couldn't believe it. You got to be kidding. We just came from there, Lord, and they were trying to kill you. You want to go back? Let's go find some other place to minister. Surely there's another town somewhere where they're not so hostile towards you. But he goes on. You know, are there not 12 hours in a day? If anyone walks in a day, he does not stumble because he sees the light of the world. But if one walks in the night, he stumbles because the light isn't in him. These things he said, and after that he said, our friend Lazarus is sleeping, but I go to wake him up. The disciples said, Lord, if he sleeps, he will get well. But Jesus spoke of his death, but they thought he was speaking about taking rest in sleep. Then Jesus said to them plainly, Lazarus is dead, and I'm glad for your sakes I was not there, that you may believe. Now here's the kick. Here's the kicker. Nevertheless, let us go to him. That's it. Let us go to him. We're not waiting for him to come to us. Let us go to him. All right? Be proactive. Reach out. Be offensive with the way you live and work for Jesus. Let us go to him. Yeah, they're trying to stone me, but so what? I'm on kingdom business. They won't take me out. I got things to do for God. Amen. If that's the attitude you've got, God will move heaven and earth to protect you because he needs all hands on deck. Amen? And he needs everybody, you know, on the front lines, all hands, you know, accounted for, present and ready to go, Lord. All right? Nevertheless, let us go to him. So live your life on the offensive. Keep reaching out. Don't sit in your house hiding behind your Bible hoping the devil leaves you alone. It's not the way this works. Okay? Go out there and go after him. Keep him on the run. Keep him backing up. Keep him on the defensive. Okay? Wondering what you're going to do next. Every time you get up in the morning, the devil should be running for cover. Amen? All right. Number three. Third thing I heard myself say many moons ago during that interview. Number three, understand the big picture in everything you do. Our life is not all about us. Our life is about a much bigger event, world evangelism. We are a part of something much bigger than us. The parts are not nearly as great as the sum total of all the parts. And you need to know you're a very important part in the mix. But when you're going through hell on earth, whatever that hell may be to you, you need to see past it and realize I have a mission. I have a ministry. It's the ministry of reconciliation, and I'm not finished. And I may be going through some things right now, but this too shall pass. And if it takes 5 years, so be it, or 10 years, so be it. I will outlast the devil. That's right. See, I'm not done. So I may be going through some things. I'm going through something right now with this arm the way it is. But it's just an inconvenience. I'll keep preaching. We'll keep moving forward. Whatever I go through, I go through. But we're not stopping because there's something bigger on the other side. You got to understand that, see? Paul wrote, I'll refer to it, I won't even turn there for time's sake, but in 2 Corinthians 4, verses 17 and 18, you can mark it down and check it out. He said, our light affliction is but for a moment, And that light affliction is working for us an exceeding weight of eternal glory. While we do not look at the things which are seen, but we look at the things which are not seen. Because the things which are seen are temporary, but the things which are not seen are eternal. Do you know right now in this room there are tens of thousands of angels in here? They're in the room right now. They love to listen to the Word of God. They love to go to church services like this. They love to be a part of praise and worship. They love this stuff. They're all over the place. Just because you can't see them doesn't mean they're not here. In fact, they've been here before we ever came along. Okay? The spirit world is the parent world. This is the child. All the rules and physics of this world are subjected to the laws of the spirit world, the parent world. Okay? And right now, there's angels up on the stage. I can sense them from time to time whenever I move around. I can sense them with me, you know. And when you were born, angels were assigned to you. They've never left you, okay? And many times, bad things that don't happen because the angels are doing what they're here to do, okay? You got to see a bigger picture. See beyond the temporal. See beyond what you can see. Understand there's a bigger picture out there. And I'm on my way to heaven. Listen, it doesn't matter what you're going through right now. When you woke up today, you're one day closer to seeing Jesus face to face. That ought to put a smile on your face. One day closer to seeing Jesus, one day closer to going to heaven. Are you kidding? Heaven is a perfect place. There is no sin. There's no resistance up there. There's no pain. There's no suffering. There's no crying. We don't know what a place is like that. Anybody who's ever been there never wants to come back here. Amen. That's why nobody invites me to Christian funerals. If they're saved, they're in heaven. What's that to cry about? My mother died in 2003, so they asked my wife and I to go do the funeral because my family knew that I'm a minister, so they asked me to do the eulogy and do the service. And so we flew to Cleveland, Ohio, which is where I was born and raised, home of the Browns. What a joke. But that notwithstanding, you know, we flew back there for the funeral, and, you know, all the brothers and sisters on the front row weeping and wailing because my mother's in the, you know, the body's back there in the casket behind me. And I told them, I said, why are you people crying? What? I'm not crying. Why are you crying? You know, they're all sniffling and tears and Kleenex and everything. I said, she's not there. She's in heaven. She was sick. She was sick for a long time, but she's not sick anymore. That body is not her. That's what she was living in. She's not there anymore. She's with Jesus. You know what she's doing right now? Running and jumping and dancing and clapping and shouting and screaming praise all over heaven, running on the streets of gold and all these things. She hasn't had a great time. What are y'all crying for? You love her?
Yeah.
Well, then why don't you just lift your hands and praise the Lord? Because that's where she is. If you love her, you ought to be, you know, that's why they don't want me at any of these funerals. Because, you know, I understand the grieving process. I got that. But see beyond that to where they went. Amen? They're in heaven. I said to them, I said, listen, even if she would want to come back, she wouldn't want to come back. Do you think she'd want to come back to be with you? No. Understand the big picture in everything you do. Number four, very important point. I'm not going to get to all these points, but that's all right. We'll just cover the ones that God wants us to cover. Nothing you do for God is small or insignificant. Nothing you do for God is small or insignificant. There are so many stories in the Bible. We could be here for an hour looking at all of this. But I want you to see one example of this with me. Look at Luke 1:1. Luke chapter 1, verse 1. Luke 1 and verse 1. This is a letter that Luke wrote to his friend Theophilus. I want you to read this with me and see how it's worded. Okay, Luke 1:1. It says, "Inasmuch as many have taken in hand to set in order a narrative of those things which have been fulfilled among us, just as those who from the beginning were eyewitnesses and ministers of the word delivered them to us, it seemed good to me also, having had perfect understanding of all things from the very first, to write to you an orderly account, most excellent Theophilus, that you may know the certainty of those things in which you were instructed." Is anyone here named Theophilus? Why are we reading this then? Because as far as Luke knew, when he wrote this, he was writing one letter to his friend Theophilus to clear up some theological questions that Theophilus had about what Jesus had done and what Jesus had said, because, you know, he was hearing things. Some of them were true and some of them weren't. And so Luke said, you know what? I was with the man. I'm going to write you a letter and I'm going to tell you what he said because I was there to hear it. I'm going to tell you what he did because I was there to see it, so that you can discern right from wrong, truth from error, and set the record straight. That's the purpose of the letter as far as Luke knew. But he didn't know that this is actually part of the canon of Scripture, one of the three synoptic gospels. He didn't know any of this, and God never told him. He never knew that this letter that he's writing to Theophilus would in turn be read by millions and millions of people from then until now, including us tonight. He didn't know any of this. God never told him. See, when you do what you're told to do, you may think it's a so-what insignificant act of obedience, but not to God, because you don't know who you're talking to, and you don't know what the impact will be when you do what God told you to do. And I'll close tonight's message with a story that I use along these lines because it's so personal for me. When I got saved, it was September 21st, 1978, and I was working for Owens Corning Fiberglass, the big insulation company, world headquarters in Toledo, Ohio, which is where I worked. I lived in Bowling Green, Ohio, 25 miles away. And I got saved in September of 1978. September 21st is my Christian birthday, year 1978. In December of 1978, 3 months later, I'm still working for Owens Corning, but God is beginning to deal with me about resigning my job and going to Bible school and preparing for full-time ministry. God's already working in my heart, you know, about this. So there was a day when I was supposed to take my car to the dealership for servicing. Now, I had a girlfriend at the time, so our arrangement was, she was Christian first. She actually was the one that led me to the Lord. So, you know, we arranged for her to come by my house. The two of us would drive two cars to the dealership. I would drop off my car for servicing. I would get into her car. She would take me to work and go home. And then at the end of the day, she'd go back to work, pick me up, and drive me to the dealership where I could pick up my car and I could drive my car home. That was the arrangement. So this was December, okay? Now, not out here in Southern California, but back east, you know, winter can be pretty severe, and winter storms can come and go rather quickly. And back then, there was no Weather Channel. There was no, you know, AccuWeather, none of that stuff. So, you know, what happened was, in the morning, I went to work in a suit, coat, and tie because it was unseasonably warm that day, like 55 degrees, 60 degrees in December, so everybody's walking around in just plain suits and dresses and things, you know, no coats because it's warm. But what happened during the day, this unexpected blizzard came through, and the temperature dropped like 40, 50 degrees in a matter of 8 hours, you know, and the wind is blowing and the snow's coming down sideways and the roads are all full of ice and slush. Anybody from the east? You know what I'm talking about, you know, cars are all over the place in the ditches on both sides of the road. So, you know, my ride, the arrangement was at a certain street corner at 5:30, I want you there to pick me up, and then you pick me up and take me to the dealership. I get my car and I go home. That was the arrangement. Well, I come out there at 5:30 in this raging blizzard, and I got nothing but a suit coat and a tie and a briefcase. No coat, no scarf, no gloves, no hat, nothing. So I got to go make my way several blocks from the high rise where I work to the corner, and I am standing out there, 5:30 comes and goes, and I am freezing. I'm out there holding on for dear life. I got my briefcase, you know, I'm stomping my feet, you know, and I'm rubbing my hands together trying to stay warm, you know. The wind is blowing, you know, it was terrible. 5:30 comes and goes, 5:45, 6 o'clock, nobody there. And, you know, these days you can pick up the cell phone and tell people where you are, what's going on, and back then, I didn't know where she was, and she couldn't tell me. She's creeping along on the freeway, you know, can't see 3 feet in front of her, you know, just barely making along, you know, delayed. So I'm standing there, and I'm freezing, and you know, I hear this big thud, and I look down, and there's a stack of newspapers, and I look up at the person who dropped them there, and there's this old black man. His name was Mac. He didn't have to say anything. You could just look at the guy, and you know he had a rough life. His clothes are all torn and tattered, very old. His face was weather-beaten and just red from the cold. You know, his snot was running down his nose. I mean, his ears were red. He was freezing, and he was out there to sell papers. And you could just tell he was weather-beaten and wind-blown. You know, he'd had a hard life. You could just tell. His boots were all torn, and his pants were torn, you know. He's going to sell papers on that street corner that night. You know, when the light turns red, the cars stop, he sells newspapers. Well, because of the storm, there's no cars. Everybody's gone home early, so the streets are empty. No cars. So we're standing there, and just to stay warm, we're trying to talk, just to talk to each other, to keep the lips moving. And I introduce myself to him, and he tells me who he is, you know, and all of this. And about 15 minutes into this conversation, you know, he turns to me and he says, "You look cold." "Yeah, I am cold." He said, "Here's what I'll do for you. If you watch my papers for just a minute, I'll walk up the street to that coffee shop and I'll buy you a cup of coffee." Now, he had sold one paper. He sold the paper he was selling was the Toledo Blade, and it sold for 25 cents a copy. He had sold one paper in those 15, 20 minutes. He had a quarter in his pocket. I had in my pocket hundreds of dollars. And he says to me, "I'll buy you a cup of coffee." And before I could say anything, he leaves me with the stack of papers and disappears into the snowstorm. He goes up the street. All the stores were closed. Just the coffee shop was open. You could see it through the snow. It almost looked surreal, like a surrealistic painting of some kind. He disappears into the storm and leaves me with the papers. He comes back with a cup of coffee. About 5 minutes later, a quarter's worth. You know, back then, you could buy a cup of coffee, a small cup, for 25 cents. And he bought it, took his quarter, and used it to buy me a cup of coffee. And he said, "Here, this will help." And he was colder than I was. And when I wrapped my hand around his, when I wrapped my fingers around his to take the cup out of his hand, God spoke to me. He didn't know this. I had never told him I was a Christian. I'd never told him I had just been saved 3 months before. I had never told him I'm getting ready to resign my job and go to Bible school. I didn't tell him any of this. He didn't know. But as soon as I took that cup of coffee out of his hand, God spoke to my heart and said, "You pay attention to what's happening right here. Because what he's doing for you is what you're going to be doing for the rest of your life. I am preparing you for doing what he's doing for you tonight." And he didn't know anything. He didn't know anything about who I was. He didn't know anything about my salvation, my relationship with nothing. All he saw was a cold soul on a winter's night. He had a quarter in his pocket, and he could do something about it. My ride came a few minutes later, and I got in the car, and I cried all the way home, so embarrassed and so ashamed that I didn't have the foresight to see that I've got money. I could have bought him pitchers of coffee. He had the one quarter, and he bought me what he did and changed my life, and he didn't know. He didn't know. I went home in the storm. I went back out that night to a store, and I hunted for gloves because he didn't have any gloves on. And I found a pair of gloves that I thought would be his size. And for 2 weeks, I hunted for him on the streets of Toledo after work. I went up and down the streets looking for him because he changed street corners all the time. It took me 2 weeks to find him. And finally, I found him, and I ran up from behind and pulled on his coat. Same coat, you know, had the paper bag over his shoulder. I'll never forget it. This is over 30 years ago. He turned and looked at me. He didn't recognize me right away. I said, "You remember me from the storm a couple weeks ago? You remember you gave me that cup of coffee?" His eyes lit up. "Oh, yeah, yeah. I remember you. I said, "Listen, man, you really blessed me that night. But I noticed that you didn't have any gloves on, so I got something for you." So having said that, I reached down into my briefcase. I pulled the gloves out and handed the gloves to him. I said, "Here, this might help. I know it was cold that night. Your hands get cold here. Maybe this will help you." He took the gloves into his hands, and he never put them on. He just kept stroking them in between his hands, rubbing them back and forth. He had never owned a pair of gloves in his life. This was his first pair, and he was 75 years old. 75 years old. He took the gloves. He said, "Oh, thank you." He just kept saying, "Oh, thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you." I said, "Man, you blessed me." And I never saw him again. I said, "I got to go to work. You know, it's past 8:30. I'm late already, so I'll see you." And I never saw him again. But there's two people I'm going to be looking for in heaven when I get there, outside of Jesus, of course. Caleb and Mac. I'm going to be looking for him. Because that man changed my life with a 25-cent cup of coffee and didn't even know he was doing it. Of all, we've led over 750,000 people to Jesus since then, from then until now. He doesn't know any of this. But guess what? When we stand before the Lord to get rewarded for whatever we've been graced to do by God, guess who's going to get called up to get the same rewards because he was in the right place at the right time? Don't tell me that insignificant gifts are... It's important to God. If it's important to God, it's important to you. Amen.